God bless you, my brother. Joshua, once again, I am Pastor Innocent Jackson Leyola, from Palma de Mallorca, here in Spain. The name of our church is Born Again Christian Church International. We are doing well to the glory of God. Welcome.
Thank you so much. Let's start this way. We are having a conversation around covetousness this week, which is one of the things that we are treating on this station, in some of our talk show. Can you quickly just give us, put a light to it? What is covetousness and how does it happen? Who are the people? Is it just for few people or is every human being that actually have that spirit called covetousness? What is your thought about it?
Okay, don't forget that when you first introduced me, you talked about the coronavirus and the way out.
Yes.
And before I throw light to the covetousness, I would like to draw our mind back to what is happening in society today.
Okay.
And that is the virus that is going on right now. Mm. And it's not God's mind for the children to suffer. But there are times where human beings have gone astray from the way of God. And God allowed the some epidemics to really happen, like the time of Pharaoh. Pharaoh will not allow the children of Israel to go in Exodus chapter 14. Later on, after the epidemics, he could not help than to allow the children of God to go. So the same thing now that this virus of 18 is to warn the people to come back to God, because many of them have really journeyed their way out of God. They are manufacturing evil things. They are doing some evil things. They are not supposed to put their heads. And God is shocked at releasing this allowing it. He's not the one that did it. He's not the one that formed it, but he is the one permitting it. Mm-hmm. So human beings, they are doing their thing, but God allowed it because it can also serve as a deterrent to others to learn on how to appreciate God. Very soon, as we have been praying, God is going to take it away. If you watch Isaiah 26, verse 20, the Bible says, shut yourself in for a while. After my anger is over, then you can come out. So God is angry with human beings, and they need to come back to God actually.
Before you go to that, there is something that I want us to quickly address on what you just said, because a lot of people say that, and you also said it, that God, evil doesn't come from God, but God can permit it to happen. In a situation whereby both the righteous and the unrighteous are feeling the punch now, what do you think the church needs to do?
Well, the way you declare righteous is not the way that God declare righteous. God see righteousness from his own angle, and the righteous are not affected. The righteous are not affected. God is helping the righteous, and they are not affected. We are not boasting. God knows how to do the thing so that it's not affect the righteous. But the way human beings can, separate the righteous from the righteous people, from how God sees the righteous people. The righteous are not afraid. He said we should hide ourselves inside the house, and really soon his anger will be over. Then he's going to deal with the unbelievers, deal with people that are not trusting in him, that do not put their trust in him. So God very soon will take away the anger, and the Christians are going to celebrate, and more souls are going to be migrated from hell to heaven. Whereby people begin to seek for, word of God now. Chuchen, the president of Tanzania, he has declared fasting and prayer for you. So he went to the mountain to start praying. That's the president of the nation. How many of them have done that? So God is really taking care of the whole world. And evil comes from God, and God, evil can come from God. Why? Because God made the good and the bad. But he planted it and left it there. But Satan will go and take it and use it. Are you hearing me, somebody? So Satan can take that evil and use it. But God does not throw it. Satan can throw it. But if God look at his goal, he will leave it there. Are you hearing me now?
So I'm hearing you.
Let's go to some Bible scriptures. If you go to the book of 1 Samuel, You know, you see where God permitted the evil spirit from God to attack Saul. He permitted it, but it's not the one that, you know, brought it to Saul. He permitted it. The evil spirit came to attack Saul, and enter Saul began to do evil. So, really, God permitted this epidemic, but it's not the one that is that threw it to the world. But Satan with his agents threw it to the world. But if God will not permit it, like you, Joshua, today, somebody wants to kill you. If God says you will not die, you will not die. So, you are not going to die, because God is, we still have more pain for God, and then God will help us, brother.
Thank you so much, yeah, but you have not answered the question, what the church needs to do in time like this.
Okay, now, the church is doing exactly what we are supposed to do. Mm. We are all the people, like many of us are Facebook and stay at home, like Europe here in Spain, where we are now, the government asked the church to stay at home. And from home, we are reaching the people on Facebook, on media, so different ways we were able to communicate with them. And so we are hoping, many of us are praying, we are fasting, and that is the future of the church. And very soon, God's anger will subside.
Thank you very much for that. When I threw the question last time, I mentioned the righteous and unrighteous, and you say God is not looking the way we're looking, which I completely agree with. What is the criteria we can use to know the good and the bad?
There is no particular criteria, although some criteria have been noted in the Bible, whereby Book of Matthew 7, and he said that by their fruit shall know them. But you can see that even the evil are doing that same fruit today. So it's not too easy. Except God said that, except God himself is able to pick the righteous. With the way these are now, we are not able to detect the righteous from the wicked, because the righteous also, the wicked also do like the righteous. And so it is God that will determine it. That is why we are on the last day, judgment shall start from the church, shall start from the eyes of God, and shall also affect the unbelievers. So the righteous, the criteria to look at it now, on our personal way of looking the world, is that we are able to check Matthew 7 verse 20, you know, and 21. He said, not everyone that said to me, Lord, Lord, amen, are righteous, but those that do the will of God, say, by their fruits shall know them. Which are the fruits? The fruits, some of those fruits are, you know, the Galatians 5, you see that the fruit of the Spirit, you see that the gentleness, the peace, you know, the righteousness, the peace and faith. So sometimes some evil people do exhibit some of these things, and they put on the minister's collar, pastor's collar, they hide to do evil. And so sometimes they bear the same fruit, but we have to be careful. Some people say that from Matthew 24.
Sorry, Pastor Jackson. I have a call here that I want them to also try to contribute to what I said. Deborah is with us here in Victoria and is listening as well. Deborah, how are you today?
I'm very well. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. You're welcome to this show. This is a talk show where we are addressing the issue that is happening around us. I'm talking about the covetousness. From your home view, what is the situation now in Victoria or in South Africa?
Well, first of all, we know that the coronavirus now has risen to 709 cases, which means that this thing is spreading like wildfire. Everybody has to be cautious. Everybody has to take proper precautions. The situation, we hope it will get better with the lockdown, but for now, it's just spreading like wildfire, and we just have to be very, very careful.
Okay, thank you. I'm with Pastor Jackson from Spain. We're having a conversation around it and what the church, the role of the church, and why this and what exactly we need to do. That is the conversation we are having. From your home view, what do you church needs to do in times like this?
As we all know that for now, there should be anything that's going to bring people together for now should be on hold.
Sorry to cut you short there. The government already gave a ruling saying that nobody is allowed to gather together. Exactly. That means the church is not allowed to open. So now, if I'm using the word church, I'm not referring to the building of the church. I'm referring to the people. I'm referring to the people now. In a time like this, people are not allowed to gather together anymore to have service or to pray together. So what should we do? What is the solution?
Okay, what I can say now is that this time around is when our faith as Christians, as individuals, will be tested the most. This is the time that everybody needs to draw closer to God. You know, I was listening to the radio this afternoon and I heard people are revisiting their wills. People are adjusting their wills because anything might happen. So as a Christian, as a body of Christ, this time we have to pull together in spirit and pray. Mm-hmm. You know, the Bible says the prayer of the righteous availeth much. So as a church, as a body of Christ, we have to just plead to God that whatever this is, he can bless you. Mm-hmm. I think that is the best thing we can do.
So this is not the time for the church. If I say church, I'm not talking about the building, I'm talking about the people. This is time for us to pray, not the time to panic.
No, not to panic. Mm. Because you remember also, that if I can refer to the Bible says that faith and fear cannot work together.
Mm.
So we cannot be faithful and at the same time have faith. So we just have to stick to one end of the stick, which is the faith side of the stick, and pray and just hope and pray for the best.
Okay, just hold on there. Let me just quickly go back to Pastor Jixi all the way from Spain. Pastor, thank you so much. Sorry for holding you on the line. We have Debbie as well with us online here in Pretoria, South Africa, that is joining the conversation. Sir, you are explaining something. I just want you to round up, I mean, with what you are saying, sir.
Okay, like I did say that the righteous, God will preserve the righteous because they are self-serving and he's only preserving the righteous. So let us hold on. We are praying very seriously for the whole world. And we are the children of God. With our prayers, God has assured us that these things are definitely eradicated. But the physical realm is manifesting to that issue. You know, when this gets to an end, the enemy starts to make people believe that it's going to be too much bigger. So that the enemy are doing their worst, but God has said he has eradicated. Now what we are seeing, the Bible says that Egyptians will see today, we will see it today no more. Are you hearing that?
I'm hearing you.
So very virus we are seeing that.
See it no more.
God has eradicated it. We will see it no more. It's just going. It's going.
Okay. Sorry. I just want to throw a question, the one question there, because Debbie, are you with me?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. This question, I just want us to look at this together. Is this the sign of the end time, or is just a normal phenomenon? Is it a part of the sign of the end time? Is it the fulfillment of the prophecy, or is just a thing that just meant to happen at the time it is?
Okay, is that from you as a pastor?
Anyone can handle it.
Okay, let me come in.
It's part of the signs of the end. Signs of the end has been brought to human beings many a times. Even people who were born at this generation. You check the United Kingdom record. In 1934-35, you know, an epidemic burst out in the United Kingdom, and it eliminated 88,000 died. And in 1945, the same repeated thousands died. So God is permitting this to us as a warning, but how will human beings also take it? You probably feel that everything is all right, let us continue, these are well. But God is telling them that they need to repent and give their life to him. So this is the sign of the end that God has been bringing from century to century. In this very century, we are facing this one. If they didn't still repent, and God still wants to still delay, he will still release another one again before he will finally come. So these are signs of the end. Earthquake has happened, different things happening all over the world. And so the end time is really, we are in the end time of the end time, brother. So we are thinking about the human being when they are driving, they are magic, they are enjoying it, they are really sure they will repent. But by the grace of God, God will see whether they repent or not. God is still showing to us that this end time message and signs. So I pray that everybody will hear these things and take it seriously. Not that after it's over, they go back to their seat. No. We must be serious as the way we are now. Everybody has been prayerful now. But after this situation, and many of us survive, but should we go back to the world again? Please, I'm talking to the general public. Do not go back to the world again. As Christ, God has survived you as part of the end time, be serious because anybody can go to meet the Lord anytime. Not only Christ will come to meet you here, but you can die to go and meet Jesus over there. The Bible says from Hebrews 9:27 says it's appointed unto man once to die, and after that judgment. So when somebody dies, he's already judged. So think about it. Anybody can die anytime, not only when Christ is coming. So we are already in the end time or the end time.
Thank you so much. Deborah, you want to say something?
Just to add, I agree with Pastor, just to add a little bit of what he said. It's definitely the end time. The way of God trying to get our attention as a universe.
Because in my almost 30 years of existence, this has never happened to the whole entire world at once. So this is I definitely agree. It is a sign of the end time.
Is a sign of air time. Thank you so much for that contribution there. Pastor, before you go to conversionsness, which is what we round up with, with the situation of what is happening in the world today, people have jets, but they are unable to fly it. People have car, but they are unable to drive it. What lesson this is telling us? Is there any lesson in this?
Well, you are trying to marry the conventions with what's happening. I think you are talking about that. So, they are already shocked. They are already handicapped. If you check some president president of some nation, I don't want to mention it. If you check some president today, each time they have a problem in their head or in their head, they fly to UK or fly abroad. But now, let us. You see, God can decide to handicap a man when he feels that he's overrun himself. Look at Nebuchadnezzar. If you read the book of Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar was handicapped. He said, I have got these things by wealth in the kingdom, by my power. And God said, that was about 612 BC. 612 BC happened in Babylon, in the modern Iraq. So the Nebuchadnezzar was supposed to say, I'm the Alpha and Omega. God said, okay, I can make you a beast. And he had this kingdom, but he went to the bush to spend 7 years. So that now, they are in the Kovu now. All the jets are in Kovu. The jeeps are in Kovu. The limousine are in Kovu. Let them do it. Let them fly now. Let us see. Except God build the city, the labor man labor in vain. Except God, you know, build the house. Except God, watch it over it. Did you see that? It was not just was for nothing. So they can't fly. So it's a lesson to all that we should not be conventions. Let us share our wealth to the poor. Let us build schools. Let us build hospitals. Let us help. You want to see that the world will live our brothers and sisters. You know, we are one. We should not be saying, I'm the millionaire. I'm working in my time. No, look at everyone adding what they want. They're not supporting them now. God is making nonsense of human capacity. So everybody has the capacity to let us watch. But I pray that every one of us with these other lessons, they can use these things to help the society. Many of them are going to sell their properties after this event so that they can help. They cannot help. You see, Africa. So you and I, we must be very, very serious to love our neighbors ourselves and not be because anything can handicap a man. Coronavirus or COVID-19.
Thank you so much. I think Deborah is still there. I'm not sure if he's still there. I think we lost Deborah there. But if we can get connected to Deborah, I just want her to put a point there. I mean, it's just too hard to read. But thank you so much, sir. That is exactly, I thank you that you understand where I come in. But that is exactly what we actually try to communicate to people, that it's a time for us to do the right thing. Because instead of us using our wealth to oppress others, or to frustrate others. Let's use it to do something great, something tangible to our society, especially in Africa, where we have
left.
Yes. So we, yeah. So it's a time for us to the lesson there is that no matter what you have, it not belongs to you. And that is the reason why we are not trying to terminate, I mean, to tarnish anybody's image, but we are calling all of us into awakening. I mean, to for us to realize that this is a lesson for every one of us, that we should create a world whereby people will live in harmony, where people will live side by side without any things that somebody will be looking at and say, I know I'm better than you because of 1, 2, 3. And that is what God is calling us to, as, especially as a church and as individual, that we need to
have,
use.
You have one, Mr. Joshua. The conventions as we are talking about. There are some people that are not even wed, but get their conventions. So do not try to mistake convention sense or greediness. You know, convention sense and greediness, do not try to mistake it for only for the rich. They can also be in their own capacity.
True.
So if we are talking about convention sense now, it's a topic we have to be treated in a very simple manner without being parochial about it.
True. True. And that is exactly what it is, because it's in all the level of life, not only belongs to one class. Everybody have that program. And that's one of the questions that I throw, which is what I'm going to end up with now. That is it for some group of people? Is it for everyone? Is it for some set of people? Consciousness, who are the people that actually has it? Is it everyone or just few people?
Well, everybody has conventions and has kids in one way or the other. But when it's pronounced, then people begin to see that that man is so greedy. Because it's when conventions are done in the family and between father and between husband and husband and the children, the father and the children. But based on what they are being conventions of being greedy about, when somebody has a plate of rice given to him and the other one has stolen it, he said, so me, you know, I must see these conventions. Are you hearing me now? So what I'm saying is that talking about the society at large, everyone are guilty of these conventions. And about conventions depends on what you are being conventions about. So the conventions is sounded out when it is, you know, an upright consciousness that people begin to keep and say, oh, must be a wicked person. That is one that we are talking against. You understand what I'm saying? So the conversation is being pronounced. Once it's pronounced, then the person is in trouble. So conversion is what we have to guide. Like the Bible says, book of 1 Timothy 6, it says, for godliness with contentment is great gain. So everything you have in life, whether small, you have a small to big thing, give thanks to God for it. Because when you are godly about what you have, you will not be conventious to be greedy of another one when you already have what you have. So what you have now, when it comes, the same like manner, the same like manner you can, or like manner you can share it along. But when you begin to heap it, there are some people that they have big cupboard, big safe. They are heaping money, they're heaping money, heaping money, heaping money, heaping money. And many people cry to them for help. They refuse to help. That man or that woman is being greedy. What you have, you are unable to share it out, is called conventionsness. Not only what you want to get more. What you have, and you have enough, you are not sharing that to people, to help people. You are being conventions. And you are being greedy when you want to accumulate more, when you have more of it before. So we have to be very careful, because the book of 1 Timothy 7, he said, for we brought nothing into this world. And it is certain that we can go with nothing. Why not spread this other life instead of being conventions? So conventions is the ability to accumulate more without allowing it to spread. And they are greedy. What is bringing conventions that people are afraid to do or not? I don't know where that comes from. I don't know what they come from. So let me explain more. So let us know that conventions is touching everybody on a different level. But wickedness should not be attached to anything we have been conventions about, small things that we cannot share around, but we must know that we have to share around. Verse 10 of the same Timothy chapter 6 says, he said, for the love of money is the root of all evil. which while some converted after they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. So the love for it, not that money is bad, the love for it and it made him more greedy is a problem. If you look at the president of one nation like that, there was a pack plenty of notes of their money currencies. They roam. And when the government would want to come and look at the place, send the SS to come and take it, they can investigate. The president set fire on it to burn it. They had to arrest the situation. So that is greediness and covetousness. So we have to abstain and pray every time not to be covetous. I round up this one. The Bible says from Luke chapter 12, verse 15. He said, beware of covetousness, for a man's life does not depend on the abundance of things which he possesses. So your life does not depend on what you possess, what you are able to give out to people as a head, or the heaven that we are going to, because when we are conscious of heaven, there will be less of covetousness, less be greedy. You understand? So covetousness is a crime. So we should not be covetous. We should not covet our neighbors, right? There are people now, not only money now, you left your wife, you left your wife at home. A neighbor who is covetous begin to look at your wife, want to steal your wife from you. All means. So the Bible says, do not covet another man's wife. Don't covet another man's goods. Exodus chapter 20, you know, the 10th commandment there. Don't covet another man's goods, or his wife, or his children. So people convert which does not belong to them. People, they have their own shoe, but your shoe is in their eye. Anytime they want to, they come to the brother, I need your shoe. I want to use it because it's conversion. He has his own shoe. So conversion, we have that things that people converted, but it may not be big things. But we have to know that, deal with it. What you have, be contented with it. And believe that God will give you another at the right time.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. That is a very powerful wrap up on, I mean, thank you very, very much. I really appreciate that. By the grace of God, we are looking forward to have more of the conversation. I will speak to you after the program whereby we can see how we can arrange things so that we will be having delivery now and then. Thank you so much.
You're welcome, Brother Joshua.
Thank you so much. God bless you. Have a great evening. God bless. Thank you. Bye. I will do that. Thank you. Bye. Thanks to everyone that is listening to us. Thank you very much to Deborah that came in to be part of this, that call in to contribute to the conversation we are having there. Thank you so much to everyone listening. The purpose of this is to address us and to let us know that covetousness is not a good thing. Let's be contented with what we have, because God give everybody according to his ability. God bless you real good. Have a great evening. I remain yours, Oludare Oluzan, on Cleverness Radio. It's one of your best radio all over the world. It's online radio where you can listen to things that is important about life. Share it. Go to our website, www.cleverness.com, for more information about us. It's Cleverness Radio here in South Africa. God bless you. Very good. See you on top of the hour. God bless.